Hello and welcome back to Cyprus the Chess Club Club Championship 2013. Today we are back in Group B and we're going to be taking a look at a game between Richard Garrett and Dan Travis. Well, for Richard Garrett, the tournament started well with an excellent win over Jerry Jepps, and he's lined himself up nicely for a possible qualification. The champion obviously doesn't want to let go of his title. He faces Dan Travis, the wild card, who unfortunately had a nightmare in his first game, which really would have dented his confidence, but let's see if he can put that right.
Well, here we are again, second game. I've got to play Dan Travis this time. Got the white pieces. I've never played Dan before, so I'm just going to open as my normal e4.
E4. Right, so Richard Garrett is my opponent. This is my second match at the Club Championship. I feel very lucky to be here, but my first match was very tough. I'm hoping I'm going to make a better game out of this one. So let's play an opening that I quite like. Let's start with the French. So e6.
Well, he's played e6, the French. I thought you played some sharp stuff, but I thought he was a sharp pair, but never mind. I'll go with my normal d4.
d4, okay. Well, the standard thing here is d5, so I'll play d5.
Right, he's played d5. This is all book stuff so far, so I'm just going to go to a trash variation. Knight d2.
Knight d2. So I was hoping for pawn takes. More straightforward, but knight d2, so standard thing here is knight f6.
Well, he's moved his knight out to f6. I expected that, so I'm just going to play e5.
d5. I was hoping Richard wouldn't play this. This starts a very closed game for black, and white has more space. I don't really like this position, nor am I very familiar with it, but I know that the standard move here is knight d2, and anyway, I don't have any choice, so knight d2.
Right, he's moved his knight to d7 from the f6 square. And then just play c3. That's something wrong here. I'm just going to play bishop to d3 after he's just moved his knight back to d2.
Bishop d3. Well, I'm going to have to try and open up this game. The standard thing here is c5. I'm playing c5.
Well, it's still following the book lines to play pawn to c5. I'll just play c3 and we'll stay in the book. See how far we go.
c3, protecting the central d4 pawn. I'm going to try and increase the tension and pressure on that d4 pawn. Knight c6.
No surprises, the knight's come back to c6. I'll just play my knight to e2 now to support my centre pawn.
Knight e2. Well, this is about as far as my opening theory stretches, so I guess I'm on my own from now. B6 seems like a good option to support my c5 pawn. Other options, I guess, bishop to f7. But I don't want to commit to my bishop to that square just yet, nor do I want to move my queen. So I want to free up some squares for my white bishop. I'm going to move b6.
Ah, that's a surprise. I didn't expect him to play b6. He should have left his knight there and played b6 earlier, because then he could have brought his bishop out to a6 to try and swap my light square bishop. This is unusual. I'm just going to castle and see what he does next. Castle.
Richard castles. Right. I guess I'm just going to have to continue with my plan to perhaps castle queenside. I think Richard's going to come up with quite a strong attack on the king's side here. So I'm going to move my bishop to b7. Bishop to b7.
Ah, he's played bishop to b7. Now I'm really confused. That bishop's probably never going to get into play. That's got to be the wrong square for the bishop. I'm going to just drive my pawns forward. Right. f4.
f4. I was right about his attack on the king's side. But I don't seem to have enough time to castle here. I suspect he's going to bring all of those pawns forward, move his knight to f3, and come up with a quite a strong attack. I also need to mix up the game, because Richard knows his theory. I need to come up with something that's a little bit different. I'm going to try h5 here, with a view of a kingside attack of my own, and also preventing him from advancing his queen on that white diagonal there. So I'm going to try h5.
Oh my god, he's played h5. That does nothing. That just weakens all his light squares around his king. I've got to be winning now. I just play f5.
f5. God, I didn't think he was going to attack that quickly. I thought he was going to give me a bit more time than this. Perhaps free his bishop or move one of his knights out of the way. But no, he's gone straight in there with f5. This looks very strong. I'm not sure what I can do. I need to try and castle. Castling kingside is obviously dead. I'm going to move my queen out of the way and try and get my king into safety before he gets to me. Queen c7.
Queen to c7. He could be trying to castle queenside, but I don't know if he's got time. I'm just going to capture on e6.
Richard takes on e6. This is looking very bad. If I take back on e6, he checks me with his white bishop. This is looking very bad. What the fuck did I play? Richard takes on e6. This has all happened rather quickly. My king's under a lot of pressure here. If I don't take back, he's going to capture my knight. I got to take back, but this leaves an awful check on g6 with his bishop. I think this game is pretty much over, but I'm going to have to take on e6.
Yeah, he's captured back. Now I'll stop him casting queenside. I'll put that bishop in g6. Bishop to g6, check.
And he does do a nasty check on g6. This is looking very bad. I've only got a couple of squares open to me. Both seem unattractive. I just can't believe how quickly he's got into such a good position. And my kingside completely blown. I'm going to have to go to d8. King d8.
He's moved king to d8. I suppose e7's a little bit dangerous once I played my knight to f6, because my other bishop was threatening to come in, check winning a piece. So, okay, well, I'm going to move my other knight anyway and attack his weak pawn that he can't defend. So knight to f4.
Knight f4, well, threatening the fork and to capture my pawn on e6 there. There's only one move to defend that pawn. I'm going to have to move my king to e7.
Well, that's the only way you can defend it. He's moved his king back to e7. Of course, I can't play the bishop to g5 now because the knight's in the way. I'm just going to move my other knight to f3 and bring that one into play. Knight to f3.
Richard's moved his knight to f3, so obviously a very strong move advancing his pieces towards and strengthening his kingside attack. Whereas my pieces are all virtually boxed in. I'm going to have to come up with something here to improve my position. All of my pieces are boxed in. And it's all to do with this e5 pawn firmly in the center there, stopping all of my development. I'm going to have to sacrifice a knight. Knight takes on d5.
Oh, I didn't expect that. Knight takes e5. He's just trying to break it up in the center. I'll capture back with the pawn. Pawn takes e5.
Pawn takes knight on e5. Well, I'm going to capture his pawn with my knight. Hopefully this will release some tension and open up the game a bit and give my king a chance to escape. Knight takes on e5.
Well, he's captured back with the knight. I've got lots of moves here. I must be winning this. I mean, it's loads of combinations. I'm just going to play knight takes knight and keep his queen and king in the center. Knight takes knight.
He takes my knight on e5. Well, queen takes his knight on e5.
Yeah, queen takes knight, forced. Right, what do I play here? I could play bishop takes pawn with a nice little fork on g6. I could play rook to e1, hitting his queen. Or I could try and get in on f7. There's possible sacks on e6 with the knight, followed by rook to e1. Or even on d5 that's possible. When he captures with bishop, I play rook to f7, but I don't think that does anything. No, I'm just going to play it safe. I'm just going to play my queen to f3 and threaten to go into onto f7. So queen to f3.
Queen f3. So things are a little bit more open for me. But queen f3 is a good move because it prevents my pawn on d5 from advancing, which is kind of what I was hoping for by sacking my knight earlier on. And he's also threatening to get his rook on the e-file, perhaps with his bishop on d2. I feel like my e-file is a little bit weak. Perhaps I can retreat the queen and then advance my d-pawn and threaten his queen at the same time as opening that white diagonal there. I think I'm going to do that. Queen on c7.
He's brought his queen back to c7. I'm just going to attack his pawns now. Right, rook to e1.
Rook e1. I guess a weakness in my last move was to open that file straight away for his rook, and he's clearly exploited that. But I'm not sure he was expecting the advance of my e-pawn here. So I'm going to play e5. Let's see what he does with that.
Right, he's played e5 now. I think I've got a win now. After knight takes pawn, check, he's forced to take, queen takes, hitting his rook, he's got to move his rook somewhere, bishop over to g5 is mate. There's no defense. Just knight takes pawn, check.
Knight takes on d5, well, he's checked my king and forking my queen at the same time. I'm going to have to take back. Bishop takes on d5.
Yeah, bishop takes knight. Right, queen takes bishop. Bye-bye rook or bye-bye king. Which one is it?
Well, I guess I overlooked the position I'd be in here. Queen takes d5. He's threatening all sorts of things here. I think it's pretty much dead in the water, but I'm gonna threaten his queen and see what he does. Rook d8.
He's just played his rook to d1. He's not seen the mate. Here it comes. Bishop to G5, mate. Thank you, Dan.
Well, there you have it. A second win for Richard Garrett in this group as he crushes Dan Travis's French defence in style. With two wins from two games then, Richard Garrett is in command of this group. Next time, we'll be looking at the second round two match in Group B as Jerry Jeps looks to open his account but takes on the formidable Tyson Mordew, who will be looking to catch up Richard Garrett. See you for that game soon.